just a quick pre-video message. It would be very helpful, although not absolutely essential, if you've watched our Primes and Primitive Sets video that we did earlier with Jared. I'll put links to it in all the usual places.
We've come up with a rule that assigns every set a number.
Almost like a fingerprint.
Yeah, exactly. So today, Brady, we're going to be talking about the fingerprint numbers. We're going to give a nice status update on some interesting conjectures. So if you're looking at primitive sets of odd numbers, then there is still a glimmer of hope that we can get a nice decomposition into odd primitive sets. So Erdős was very interested in understanding how to maybe take collections of numbers and compress them down into just one number or one value, which can convey some added information. And so in this case, we're looking at the fingerprint numbers. So they're defined as an infinite series, one fingerprint for each k, as the infinite series of 1 over n log n, ranging over numbers that have exactly k prime factors. So for example, the first fingerprint number, f1, is the sum over all numbers that have exactly one prime factor. So in other words, the prime numbers themselves. So sum over primes p of 1 over p log p. So this is nothing more than just the sum of 1 plus 2 log 2, 1 over 3 log 3, plus 1 over 5 log 5, and so on. So one term in the sum for each prime. This series turns out to converge to about 1.636. So we're going to have a bunch of these series, these fingerprint numbers, one for each k, and there are many fascinating questions about these numbers, some of which are due to Erdős, one of which is the Erdős primitive set conjecture, for some fans on the channel. Another one, which is could be viewed as a vast generalization, is a conjecture of two mathematicians, Banks and Martin, where they predicted, so not only the first fingerprint number, the largest, but we have this interesting chain of inequalities that f1 is bigger than f2, is bigger than f3, is bigger than f4, and so on, this infinite chain of inequalities.
Two prime factors, all the numbers with three prime.
Exactly, so each of these fingerprints corresponds to a whole collection of numbers, and the kth fingerprint number looks at the numbers with exactly k prime factors. And so not only in this conjecture, we have this kind of beautiful relation, it actually applies in a much more general setting. So I'm not going to maybe go in the full generality, but another interesting case is to consider odd numbers. So we can consider the same series, let's say call it gk, as the sum of 1 over n log n, ranging out now over these odd numbers n, but as before, they just have exactly k prime factors. So this is another example of these kinds of sums in the conjecture, and the prediction is that similarly, these sums are decreasing at each step. So g1 is bigger than g2, is bigger than g3, and so on. So as I said before, this is really kind of an important testing ground to see if we have a good understanding, and in the most general setting of the Banks and Martin conjecture, really says something important about the structure of primitive sets. So I want to maybe go to a new piece of paper.
We don't know that they all get smaller, but it looks
like that's the expectation. And so today, as a status update, we have some math news that in collaboration with my co-authors, Ophir Gorodetsky and Modik Wang, we are able to prove the odd version of the conjecture holds eventually. So what do I mean by this, Brady? New result, I guess hot off the presses, this odd version of the conjecture holds eventually. So let me maybe be a little bit more precise. So we show that there's a large enough constant k, we show that gk satisfies the property, so gk is bigger than gk plus 1, it's bigger than gk plus 2, and so on forever. So we don't necessarily know that the whole chain of inequalities is working, but we know at least far enough down the chain that this starts to kick in.
Oh, right, okay. Is there anywhere earlier in the chain where it doesn't work?
No, so we've also checked the... So this is a very good question. So we showed very large k holding in this theorem. On the other hand, we can just plug in on a computer and verify the first cases. So this is a very pertinent question. So we can look at maybe a plot of what these fingerprint numbers look like. So k up to 15, we can actually compute these directly on the computer, and we see, for example, g1 starts out a little bit larger than 0.9, g2 is a little bit larger than 0.6, g3 is smaller, g4 is yet smaller, and at each step, it seems to be getting smaller and smaller. So what we actually prove in this result, so this is essentially a corollary, we get an approximate formula for gk as being approximately 1/2. In the limit, this sequence of gks converges to 1/2. And this is a trend that we can already kind of eyeball in the data, but we actually prove that it does so very fast at an exponential rate. So there's a secondary term which decays as like 2 to the k. So you have this kind of nice exponential decay. And the key point with this result is that initially our series gk is defined as an infinite sum. So maybe from the beginning you would think you would have to add up each term and, you know, wait a very long time. But this formula here is giving us kind of essentially a shortcut, a way to kind of get to the answer at the end of the line without having to do all the tedious computations. And then we can actually see kind of conceptually why we're getting this data to really kind of bend towards 0.5.
You and your collaborators have proven that eventually this holds true.
Right, right.
And you've just physically looked at the fact that it holds true at the start.
Yeah, yeah.
At what point are you confident that your proof kicks in? There's no set number where your proof kicks in, like at like a million or a...
Right, so I'm sure... So what I am confident about is that if we really worked very hard at ironing out all these details, we could maybe come up with some concrete number, maybe like a million or 10 to the 100 or something like this. But definitely it would require some considerable effort to... So in the math lingo, we say we want to make these results explicit. There's a gap between looking at very large numbers on the one hand and very small numbers, which the computer can handle. And we really want to make these results explicit in the sense that we want to fill in all the gaps and have a complete understanding of the sequence. Brady, so maybe you know, the word explicit nowadays takes on an extra layer of meaning. So for example, if you're listening to a song on the radio, you maybe hear your favorite song and has some beeps in it. You know that, you know, the broadcasters had decided this wasn't ready for the clean version. When you hear these beeps, that really motivates me to, you know, go look up the song up on my own, like on YouTube, and to really hear all the lyrics in the explicit version. And so in the same sense of it being explicit, as mathematicians, when we are presented with a kind of nice clean result like this that holds eventually, really kind of motivated to want to go dig into the details and kind of iron everything out explicitly.
So you've shown me that the chain holds at the start, and you've proven that the chain holds up high.
Yeah.
If you found one exception, one place where it doesn't hold, like, you know, at 1,000, would that break your heart or would it excite you?
Okay, so this is, a moment of foreshadowing, because we actually also have shown an analogous result for the original fingerprint numbers. This came as something of a surprise to us. We have an analogous result which says that the conjecture for the original fingerprint numbers fails eventually. So the opposite happens. So we prove that for k large, the fk is less than fk plus 1, is less than fk plus 2, and so on forevermore.
Where does it switch?
Yeah, so this is a great phenomenon. So we have a kind of corresponding plot of the original fingerprint numbers. So we can see, as we saw, F1 is about 1.6, a little larger. F2 is a little bit larger than 1.1. And then at each step, it seems to go down and down, but maybe eventually it starts to tail off towards 1. So maybe initially we were thinking, okay, this could be the same kind of phenomenon we were seeing in the odd case. But if we start to zoom in, if we really zoom into this area here, we start to see at around 5 and 6, it dips down to the minimum and then starts to rebound and actually go up. So what we actually prove is that for k large, we get an approximate formula, as before, that fk is converging to 1. So now if we include both the even numbers and the odd numbers, these sums converge to 1, but they do so from below. They go up. So now we have this minus sign, where we also have a constant, now times k squared over 2 to the k. So essentially we have this nice exponential decay to the limit, but it's now coming from the other side. And this was a surprise to us.
And what happens now?
Yeah, so...
Is this like a big deal? Like...
So I definitely would, you know, view this as being an important milestone in trying to kind of nail down the full conjecture. So this idea of making results explicit has a, you know, very rich history in math. So maybe the best example that people are familiar with is with the Goldbach conjecture. So for fans of the channel, the weak Goldbach conjecture says that every odd number bigger than 5 can be written as a sum of 3 primes. And this was, you know, famously made as a conjecture by Goldbach to Euler, which stumped Euler. And for hundreds of years, mathematicians tried to really prove this. And about 100 years ago, mathematician Vinogradov proved in 1937 that this conjecture of Goldbach holds eventually, holds in the limit. And then it took over 80 years until 2013 for Harold Helfgott to finally nail down the solution completely. This is definitely a general arc, a story arc that happens in mathematics and mathematics research, that there is a milestone where one can hit to get a kind of clean conceptual understanding, but there's still a lot of work to do and new ideas to develop sometimes to really nail down the explicit version.
99 consecutive numbers, none of which can be prime numbers. And so you know that there has to be this gap between prime numbers of size at least 100. But obviously, you can replace 100 here with any number you like, and that shows that there are arbitrarily large gaps between prime numbers.